Tom Fox, thank you so much for coming on the Inner Edison show today. I really appreciate it.
Ed, it's a pleasure to be here with you.
Yeah, you say that now. You sound like you have a Texan accent. You from Texas?
I am. Lived here 62 years of my 66.
I was going to say, it can't be many more gone. Where'd you go? Where were you elsewhere?
Grad school and law school in the great state of Michigan.
Great state of Michigan, but you're in Texas. You still say that? Hi, so you like Michigan, I take it?
Well, I was 21. I had seen snow twice. I'd heard of Yankees, but never actually met one. I thought, what the heck? I'll go up there, and I was a 21-year-old in snow, and it doesn't get any better than that.
I take it in Texas doesn't have anywhere there's snow?
Up until a couple of years ago, I think I had seen snow 4 times in 40 years.
Wow.
I had a really bad freeze a couple of years ago.
Yeah, I remember that.
200-year freeze, yeah.
Yeah, messed up the glue that is for the certain board, so they couldn't make the board during for a period of time. But you guys get a golf ball held real well. You do that really well. Yeah, because I actually went to, when I was in the Navy, I was at San Antonio, Texas, at the Fort Sam Houston, whatever that is, in San Antonio, you know. And for a specialty school. And then 20 years later, I was back there because my son was going through his AIT there. So it was
great. Well, I live 50 miles west of San Antonio.
Okay. Well, I'm just saying, and when I was there at the golf ball hill, I mean, it dented everybody's car. And it was like, don't worry about it. Get hot enough during the summer, it'll come out.
Yeah. Not a problem.
Yeah. But we're not here talking about Texas or anywhere else. I want to talk about Tom. And before we started, I was asking you, you said there's two things you do, compliance and podcasting. And you told me you'd had like 60 shows or something like that.
Right.
All right. So let's dive a little bit deeper in that. So how do you do? So do you, how many currently do you have going right now? Let's put it that way.
Probably 50.
50 podcasts. And you do an episode. Dailies, how many dailies?
Weeklies, bi-weeklies. Some special series. I have two dailies going. I have 10 weeklies, and the rest are bi-weeklies.
So then you have another, so that's 12. So you have another 40 or something like that, that are twice a week.
Yeah. Is it twice a month.
Twice a month. Okay. And is it by yourself? All of them, or you have a co-host, or how's it work?
I produce and or host 98% of those.
All right. So you produce, that means you help other people run their podcast. You just produce it.
Right.
Okay. Cause I have a radio show that I do locally, and we have a producer is in my ear while we're doing the show. Is that basically what you do?
No, I just do it.
You do everything.
Yeah.
You don't tell them what to do. You just do everything. I'm just saying, I'm trying to understand the producer part, because some people can't even do one podcast, right? It's a lot of work. And we were talking beforehand, I did the 1023 talk on podcasting where I researched it, and it seemed like most people quit by the 10th episode, they were done. They didn't do it. And then the next part was the 23rd episode. If you get past those things, you pretty much have it. But I think people stop because they don't understand the cost and the time involved. You have to put in the time.
Absolutely true. And they're not seeing the benefit. They think basically, if I build it, they will come. Well, they'll come, but you just have to do two things. You have to put out podcasts consistently. Whenever you say you're going to do it, you say twice a month, fine. Twice a month on Wednesday, fine. But do it twice a month on Wednesday. And then put out quality content.
And what's your phrase of quality content?
I have two requirements, and two requirements only for a podcast. Number one, how much did I learn? Number two, how much fun did I have? Other than that, I don't care. Now, that may sound selfish, but the reality is, because I learned something, I am totally engaged.
Right.
And if I'm having fun, well, it just takes it up to 11. And so I don't talk about topics that don't interest me. I'm only passionate about, the things I enjoy. And it gives the listener an experience that they enjoy because I enjoy it so much.
Right. So what are you passionate about?
Compliance.
Most of us run from compliance.
Most people run from compliance. I got into this field about 15 years ago, and I decided that's what I was passionate about, because the world's economy loses $3 trillion a year annually to bribery and corruption, $2 trillion a year annually to money laundering. And I found that it was something I could do in the corporate world, because I do come out of the corporate world, to fight corruption every day. And I'm incredibly passionate about that fight. And every day I'm doing something. And if it's talking to you about compliance, there may be one person who hears about it for the first time and goes, you know, that makes sense. I'm going to check that out. That's enough for me. So every day in every way, I'm fighting corruption.
So this corruption, what do you mean by corruption? Right. You see, how does compliance help that?
So in the corporate setting, corporate compliance puts policies and procedures in place to prevent companies from violating anti-bribery, anti-corruption laws. There is a U.S. law called the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act that prevents U.S. companies from engaging in bribery and corruption outside the United States. And that was, I worked on that law when I was in the corporate world, so I was familiar with it. And I help companies build out compliance programs so that they don't violate that law. What finally dawned on me was that, you know, this is not simply Dr. No in the land of no, the business, Department of Non-Business Development. Properly seen, compliance is a business process. And if it's a business process, you can improve it. And if you can improve it, you can make your overall business processes more efficient, leading to greater profitability. So I'm a big advocate that effective compliance equates directly to greater ROI.
All right. So on your bribery, you're talking about, is that when they come to you to get something done in a country potentially because, and they, you know, kind of like the mob used to do in Chicago and other places?
Well, it's actually not quite that invidious, but it can be as simple as bags of cash across the border to get a license. It can be a payment for a contract. It can be a payment to get something done that you weren't entitled to. So it's a wide variety of things. It generally involves transactions to make sales, because that's what companies are interested in.
Right. Well, the reason I'm saying, like, I'm in the mortgage industry, the real estate industry, and there in certain areas that in the past, if you wanted something done, you had to grease the wheels, and especially in other countries, right? And that's what you're saying, right? That's the problem, and that's what compliance you're putting into place so that that doesn't happen.
Correct.
Or it does it, or it happens properly.
Or it happens properly.
Right. That's basically what you're saying. This is the only way we can do it properly.
Right.
And it wouldn't, right? That's so you put in, this is what this company, and I guess for somebody like myself that don't do a lot of stuff out of country, is that a huge market for corporations?
No, but they're California, for instance,
that's where I'm at.
State anti-corruption law. And that state anti-corruption law says you cannot pay more than $1,000 for a benefit. Under 1,000, not illegal. Above 1,000, if you paid somebody $1,000 for a license, that's illegal under California state law. So there are, I don't want to say there are no domestic anti-corruption laws, but it's state by state. In the great state of Texas, there's no dollar limit. It's anything for a benefit. That can be a meal, conceivably, or anything else. But there's 37, I had to look at this one time, there are 37 state laws dealing with anti-bribery, anti-corruption inside the United States. And they vary from $0 to California with 1,000.
Is California the largest with the 1,000?
The time I looked at it, it's been a while, but it was.
I can see why. It's the people who run our country, our actual state. I can see that. They want to have a certain dollar amount so they can make sure they can do what they want to keep doing. I mean, this is a unique subject. How did you find out that this is what you loved?
I am a recovering trial lawyer. I did that for 25 years. And then I went into the corporate world. I did international contracts, lived abroad. And then I became a general counsel of an energy company in Houston. And that company had violated the law. I talked about the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And I was part of the new management team that was brought in to remedy that breach and put a compliance program in place. That's where I discovered compliance. And then the company got sold, my job went away, and I was 50. I could race in the senior division. So I went off on this great adventure of bicycle racing. for about a year until I was taken out by a Hummer on a training ride. So that ended my cycling career.
I'm sorry about
that. At that point, after convalescing for a couple of months, I realized I was going to have to go back to work. So I got on my walker and toddled into my office and thought, what do I want to do? I'm 50 years old. I can do anything I want. And I decided compliance was what I really enjoyed, and I could see a benefit literally across the world. At that time, there were very few lawyers building out compliance programs. If, excuse me, they were in compliance, they usually did investigations or negotiated with the government. And I was really intrigued with the nuts and bolts of compliance. How do you build a program inside a company? So I became known as the nuts and bolts guy.
Did you write any books on it called The Nuts and Bolts of Compliance?
I'm not sure I've ever used that title, but I've written 28 books on compliance, business ethics, and leadership in the past 13 years.
Well, I'm just, you came up with it, nuts and bolts guy. I thought for sure you'd use it as one of your books, or is that one of your podcast names?
I haven't used that yet, amazingly enough.
Yeah, well, maybe that'll be your next one.
Got enough monikers, so.
Anyway, so back to your racing. So you've been cycling your whole life till you got hit?
No, I started cycling in about 2014. They have a great race for charity every year in Houston called the MS-150. And it's for the MS Society. It's from Houston to Austin. It's actually 180 miles. And anyone interested, literally anyone can ride in it and anyone can finish it. And so I started riding in the MS every year. And that led to deciding I had, like I said, I got laid off and I had a package. So I thought, what a big Joe Jock in high school. I love competition. So I went off on this great adventure.
Are we talking regular pedal cycling? Are we talking motors? Okay. Yeah. So I've been riding. Yeah. I've been riding since I was a kid. I used to drive right out to my grandfather's dairy, and that's where I got into it. Then in the Navy, I was in San Diego, and the freaking, you ride out of the coast all the time. And I got into triathlons and stuff like that. And I was my thinnest down there until I moved up here. And that's, you know, we get 115, you know, in the summer. So it's really hard to ride during the summer. And so I rode for a long time, but then it's just gotten so crazy in the last few years with people not caring who, you know, driving and running people over, you know?
Well, I'm certainly well aware of that.
Yeah, I know.
Almost every cyclist I know has been hit at one point in their career.
Yeah. It's to a point where it's like, I just do the Peloton now. For me, I just, too many people, you know, it's too much, too risky for the rest of your, what you want to do over the rest of your life to be out there with these people. So,
right.
Yeah. And again, I'm sorry that you got hit, but it got you into compliance, right? Got you to where you are now.
It was obviously a life-changing event, but it taught me a couple of things. Number one, I'd always known that when the universe closes one door, another one opens. What I didn't fully appreciate was you have to have the courage to walk through that door. And because of the circumstances I was in, a lawyer with no work and no clients, I had to do something. And I thought, well, why don't I do this that interests me? And the two best pieces of advice I got were a woman told me, if that's what you want to do, great, but you have to give it a year. Don't do it for 3 months and conclude it's a failure. And number two, don't be like every other lawyer I know who says I can do anything, which I was one of those. She said, if you want to do that, if you want to do compliance, just do compliance. And she was spot on. And I still cite her to this day, as I just did, for that advice. And it suited me. I created an entire worldwide consulting business out of my office at home way before we called it working from home.
Are you still doing the same thing right now? I mean, do you still have the consulting business or?
I still have it. But I don't say it very loudly and I don't say it very often that I still do that work. I'm full-time podcasting now.
And does that pay the bills?
It does.
And how does that pay the bills? Do you get sponsors or?
So in 2017, I got this bright idea. I'd always written as a lawyer. So I started blogging. That led to the book writing. That led to podcasting. So in 2012, I started podcasting. I got this broad idea that I would create this compliance podcast network to be a resource for compliance professionals in the podcast format. And so I went around, there are three big trade organizations in the compliance world. I went to each one of them. I said, hey, let's create this consortium. Number one, we'll provide this resource. Not that I would ever suggest anything anti-competitive. We'll corner the market on advertising. And I could get no one to interest. They all said no. So I said, okay, I'll do it myself. So
well, you were ahead of the curve. First of all, right. That's 2012, 2007, you know, that was way before people even knew. I mean, it's been around forever, but not many people really were into it until just recently.
Right. So I putzed around with it for a couple of years. In 2019, I said, I either have to commit or move it to hobby status. So I quit practicing law, quit practicing compliance, dedicated full time to podcasting, bought all the cool toys, built this huge network and infrastructure. And at the end of the year, I'd made about $10,000. And I thought, well, that was an interesting experiment. I gave it a shot and time to go back to practicing law and compliance. So I started that in Q1 in 2020, and all that ended when they shut the country down on March 15th. And what happened was on about May 15th, I got the same phone call from every product provider in my space, which was, how long do you get access to your network? Because I had the biggest social media presence in compliance. And back then, almost all marketing was done in person. Trade show, conference, breakfast roundtable, whatever it may be. And of course,
Your industry, for compliance.
For my industry, yes. Okay. Yeah. For my industry.
Because most people, again, we go, it's such a boring subject that we don't want anything to do with it. And please don't take that wrong. That's just, most people thought of compliance as not something like you think of it. You're a very unique individual.
So my little world exploded. I went from $5,000 a month to $35,000 a month in 1 month. And since that time, I've just tried to keep and consolidate the explosion of growth I had immediately during the pandemic, because marketing is still done. Obviously, trade shows and conferences are back, but the podcast world is seen as a viable alternative now.
Yeah, it's one way to get your message out to everybody that you deal with, who you are. Right. It's amazing. It's two platforms that you can't. So it's like talk radio, which is still free, and podcasting is free, meaning that you can say whatever you want on podcasting. It's your podcast. They can't shut you down.
Right.
And that's the difference. That's why it does so well.
And I realized what I have is a distribution channel, and I can distribute any message I want, whether it's my message of interviewing someone, or whether it's a company's corporate message of their product, their service, whatever that might be. And I finally have figured out how to demonstrate the entire reach of my network, not just downloads or CPM, whatever the measurement that advertisers use. And I come in between 450,000 to 500,000 downloads, hits, impressions per month with everything I post on. So when people want to say, what's your reach? I said, here's the reach. Here's the messages you will get and touch points you will have if you're on my network.
And so you did such a niche. And so the old statement is the riches are in the niches, right? You niche down to exactly what was important, especially to you and what you did. And this is what most people don't do. When they, okay, who's your podcast for? Who is your YouTube channel for? Any of the stuff that we do, social media, whatever, they don't know who their perfect client is. You do.
You're absolutely spot on. And someone had given the advice, I would say, if you want to go big, go niche. And that's exactly what I wanted to be. I wanted to be the biggest whale in a very, 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 very little pond. And it served me extraordinarily well.
Yeah, because most people say fish. The biggest fish, you said whale.
Well, with 50 podcasts, I can qualify as a whale.
No, but I'm just saying it's how you look at it is totally different. And the fact that you were probably the first in the market for compliance for this subject, where there's so many different podcasts out there and different things out there. But again, they don't niche it down. Who's your perfect client?
Right.
All right. You do. And you know who that is.
And for me, it's a natural extension of my entire social media production process of writing. So I say, you give me a word, I'll give you a sentence. You give me a sentence, I'll give you a paragraph. You give me a paragraph, I'll give you an article. You give me an article, I'll give you a white paper. You give me a white paper, I'll give you a chapter to a book. So every podcast can form the basis of a blog post or an article, and that feeds into my book writing process. And that's how I'm able to turn out 4 or 5 books every year.
Wow. and it's all in compliance and everything. So you're really what they tell us we should be. You've actually done it.
In compliance.
Well, of course, yeah. Well, that's, yeah, that's your niche, your compliance niche. And that's your, I mean, but that's your field. You were an expert in it, right? That's what you knew. You knew it. And you knew that you need to get that word out to everybody. And finally, they found you because of what you were in the right place. People would call you lucky, but you're not. You were opportunity meets preparation and you were ready for it. So
that is one of my favorite phrases. And that's exactly what happened. People say, what's the single best thing you can do for a podcast? It's the following. Start a daily news podcast. I don't care what topic. And I stole that idea, or I should say I got it, from a guy who does an Indiana basketball podcast. And that's his podcast, but he does a daily Indiana basketball news show, 4 stories, 8 minutes. And I thought, brilliant. A guy at a podcast conference says, I have a podcast about Army veterans with PTSD. I said, perfect. Do a daily show on the struggles, challenges, and successes of your target audience. People will listen. You'll become the guy because you're doing it daily. You're talking about them to something to the point where so many people, I started one of the podcasts I started this summer was I do a daily news show, 4 shows. On Saturday, I take 10 of those shows and put it in a 10 spot. And that's now one of my top podcasts. I cannot figure it out, but people quick. Just love, yeah, quick daily, or in that case, weekly recitation of the top 10 compliance stories.
As what is your, Tom Fox. Your, because you said that guy with the, did an 8 minute, right? The daily. So right. I just recently went to a daily for our real estate. So I've been doing a Saturday show for real estate and finance for the last, since 2018. Right. And then it's live on the talk radio. And then we turned it into a podcast. I just recently started full, 5 days a week, 8:30 in the morning live, then turned into a podcast. Same situation, what you're talking about. But mine is about 12 to 18 minutes, depending on what's out there. So, right. So, and that's actually we're getting a huge following on the lives and the finally, we did the lives for almost a year. And then finally I'm like, what the heck am I not putting this up for a podcast? And I started just doing the podcast in the last 60 days. And it's a huge change that I've seen from doing that in the last 60 days. Cause I've had the other one for 5 years and it's totally different.
I now live in a rural area of West Texas. And about a year ago, I started a podcast network where I live. And what the inspiration was we have a 2-day a week newspaper, no TV, no radio. And a guy started a daily news show on Facebook.
Right. That's kind of what I did.
Yeah. And he was very successful, had 1500 subscribers in a town of 1100 people, 10,000 people. And I realized that there is a market for local news, except I'm going to take that to local businesses. And I say, do a podcast, but then create social media sharing materials, audiograms, videograms that you can use, throughout the year. And we started the network last October. We have 15 shows on that network now.
Have you seen Opus Pro yet?
I have not.
Okay. Well, it'll cut up 30-second clips, whatever you want, for right. shorts and everything else, but it's AI. And I'm telling you, they're just now added B-roll into it. Oh my God. It changed my life.
So I do all that manually.
I know, but I'm telling you, you can still do it manually, but you can right. also use this to create it first. It'll take seconds to do it over here. There's another, I know you like writing. There's another software called Cast Magic. You drop in your podcast, it transcribes it. And it also breaks it down for different posts for you automatically, tells you where each section of the time is. So if you want to go back in there and create the little short clips that you want for your podcast, I'm just saying it took me for what I do for a couple hours down to 30 minutes.
Right.
I'm just trying to be smarter ways of doing things. I know you're doing your own thing, and that's your love. I'm just like, okay, I also run a mortgage company.
So I use Descript and CapShow and a site called Podflow for sort of all of those things. So right. absolutely. Yeah. And I remember people told me about Descript and they all said it will change your life. And it did.
I'm just, you should really look at these other two too. I mean, cause I was, and then I tried it. I was a holy cow. And I had my first viral video off of Opus Pro. And for me, small guy in Modesto, it was, I'm at 730,000 on that one little short that I had on TikTok.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Very cool.
And that was just, and it was about buying them, putting a manufactured home on a piece of property without putting on a permanent foundation so that you don't have to pay property taxes on the manufactured home. And then you can always add the permanent foundation right before you sell it and you get full value. And it was, oh, that's tax fraud. No, it's not tax fraud. Cause I had a client who did it and I'm like, why are you doing that? Stupid. And he told me, I was like, oh, okay, I can see how you could do that. Cause later you can always do it. Well, people were complaining, you know, a few people were like, he's an idiot. And I'm like, really, you know, engage with them no matter what they say, because any engagement is good engagement. More people are negative about things than anything else. So remember that. So if they're negative about it, great. Encourage them more. Cause that's the thing went viral, cause people engaged on it. Half of them were negative. The other half were positive.
What you are doing in your industry in Modesto, that's what I'm trying to convince businessmen in my little town. This is exactly what you need to do. We've got a couple of financial advisors and they do an 8-minute daily financial advice show. And they take something that happened the night before in the market and talk about it. Well, they may not be the smartest or the best, but everybody knows who they are because they're the only one doing it.
Yeah.
And that's what I try to emphasize. You can demonstrate subject matter expertise. It doesn't matter whether you're the top or not, but you're the one talking to people. And then the power of audio. Mm-hmm. I know there's some psychological studies behind it, but the power of audio over print or even visual just stuns me.
Yeah. I mean, because at first I only did, you know, not video podcasting, right? Because it wasn't really, it's only really taken off in the last 2 years. Prior to that, right, was just audio. And then it was like, oh, now you can do video and YouTube and all this stuff. I didn't understand the whole keeping people's attention. You know, everybody's like, say, well, do different camera angles. To me, that was annoying. I didn't want to see my face so close and the other stuff. But I'm telling you, it's a huge difference when you're trying to get people the way that YouTube looks at it with the shorts and how long people stayed on your content and at 50% drop off and all this. With that product I told you about, they're slapping B-roll in there to where that would happen. And I got 120% watch time now because of that. And it didn't take me any extra time to figure it out. It took me less time because it did it.
I'll definitely check it out. I wrote it down.
Yeah. So I'm not trying to sell you on it. I'm not giving you my affiliate link. I'm just saying it's changed and it's for me, I'm the worst at writing. So when it cast magic and come up with the stuff for me and my introductions and different things, because I used to use ChatGPT, but unless you knew how to, ChatGPT is limited by how you ask it to do something. It's limited by right. You, right? And this one automatically, it's connected to all that and it automatically asks those questions for you properly. And that's what's nice about it. Because when I go to do all my lives, some of them are pre-recorded. I don't know if you know you can do that. You pre-record it, I drop it in there, I get the stuff and I put it all through. So it has everything that's needed once it hits the airwaves. But you're right. We do local radio here in this town because talk radio is so huge. Last Free Press. I didn't realize how big it was. We have 51 to 71,000 listeners a week on the talk radio station for my real estate jerky podcast or, you know, radio show. We give you something to chew on. People know who I am. People know who I am no matter where I go, whether I know them or not. Doing radio now, writing and had a book come out. And then I was in a documentary last year. That's one thing about being authority in your industry is by doing these things. And that's what you're trying to explain to those businessmen. You want to be the authority in your industry. This is how you do it.
Right.
And that's all you need to tell them. That's how they do it. But be careful. And the reason I say this is you can do too much to where people will go, oh, I didn't know you were going to call me. I said I was going to call you when we're on the radio. You know what I mean? That kind of stuff. And so people, you know, they're like somebody's, you know, celebrity to somebody, and just be careful. I think I went a little too much with the documentary but you know, I had to be that. I had to do it because there's only one of me and I don't know how much longer I'm going to be here. So
I'm completely for doing much more than anyone else. Part of that's the Joe Jock in me. Part of it's just, I only have one switch on and off.
So. Yeah. And I get that because everybody asks, I cannot believe all you're doing and everything. It's like, but it's no big deal. It's not a big deal. You're right. It's just, I have the free time. I have the time to do it. I set up another studio in my house because I go to work and I got tired. I'm tired of going to an office, you know, and getting, even though my staff works from home, but then I still get interrupted by other people in the building. Right here, I don't get interrupted by my dogs and wife when she comes home. But, you know, other than that, that's okay.
Someone at a podcast conference asked me once, what's the hardest thing about podcasting? And I thought about it a minute and I said, there's nothing hard about podcasting. Practicing law is hard. This is just fun.
Conversation.
And yeah, that's what exactly, this is what I do all day. I talk to people. Yeah. And then I get up really early in the morning or at night and do all the production work.
All right. So, when you use this other stuff and it changes your life to where you can do it so much more, less, and you can do other things like another couple podcasts, just send me an email and say, hey, Ed, yeah, it changed my life. Thank you.
Will do.
Because I know what you're going to do. Anytime you save, you're going to do another program.
Oh, I don't have to save.
No, I'm just saying, if you save any time with these softwares, whatever, that extra time that you have, you're going to put into another podcast.
Yep. No doubt.
Yeah. Well, we really didn't talk about your compliance. We talked more about podcasting, but I think it's important for people to know whatever you're good at, niche it down, and that's what you need your podcast to be.
That's perfect, Ed. I could not have said it any better.
That's, you have to, it used to be stated the riches are in the niches, would sound horrible, but it's true. Niche it down to the smallest one you can get to and be the authority in that niche. And you will be taken very good care of. Because this, I talk to people in London, everywhere else on my podcast, my book that I came out, I'm on so many podcasts. I was in Brazil, you know, places you're like, what? I would not normally be here if it wasn't for podcasting.
Well, and in terms of niche, people say, well, how do you have so many podcasts? Well, I'll tell you how I have so many podcasts. Weekly compliance, daily compliance, nuts and bolts compliance, daily tip of the day compliance, Star Wars in compliance, Star Trek in compliance, Sherlock Holmes in compliance, Shakespeare in compliance, the original series of Star Trek, all 79 episodes, trekking through compliance, sports in compliance, great women in compliance, roundtables in compliance, human trafficking in compliance. I get an idea and I start a podcast.
Star Wars in compliance?
Absolutely.
Well, how's it? Explain to me that one.
The empire was process. So where did they fail in process? Oh. And what lessons can you take away? And of course, you want to talk about ethics. We can talk about ethics in Star Wars, but it's just an excuse for me to rewatch these movies and talk about them with somebody who loves them as much as me.
Well,
every summer.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Every summer I do trekking through compliance, and my wife, finally, this was the fifth straight year, and my wife said, are we going to have to watch every episode again? I said, well, of course. That's the whole point in doing this series.
That's funny. And ethics, right? And morals. Those are two things that could be different for other people. And I think a lot of people think, I've heard when people, he has no morals. No, he has his own morals. He just doesn't have your morals. Right. We all have ethics, but it might not be the same ethics, even though we should, but everything's different. Exactly. So you kind of put in, this is how normal society would be for ethics and normal. Is that how you do it?
I would say the values of your business should prevent you from engaging in criminal activity.
So whatever that
part of that's the lawyer, me speaking, right. But if it's not criminal and you're not hurting anyone, that should be a value that you can embrace.
So basically what you're saying is you can bend the law as far as possible. Just don't break it.
Well, I would say don't get too close to the line, but you can move up to it. Don't kick dust on it.
Yeah, don't kick dust on it. Don't step over the line. Don't scratch like in bowling.
So if you scratch, then you are subject to getting penalized, right, whether that's a civil fine or a criminal penalty.
Because I'm in the mortgage industry, which is in the real estate side of it, which I'm run by the Department of Real Estate. So we have total compliance stuff that we have to do all the time, day in and day out. And there's a lot of people who don't do anything. And they get away with it until somebody complains about it. Right. So.
Was a big bellwether for a lot of people in that industry.
Yeah. Yeah. Because just a little quick on my side, but I did a lot of the world savings loans, which was pick a pay, which was only for business owners, right? Because everybody, as a business owner, 1 month you might make a lot of money, next month you might not make as much, but you didn't always know perfectly. Then what happened is Countrywide, WAMU, and all these started getting, they like, hey, this is a great program. Let's do it to wage earners, people who know exactly how much they're making every month. You do this, and that's where we got into trouble, and that's all that stuff. And then the rating agencies didn't rate it properly. They rated them AAA when they should have been D's. And if they would have rated them properly, nobody would have bought those mortgages.
And then they collateralized it, and when it all went down, everybody went down.
Yeah, but not the rating agencies.
They didn't even get civil fines, no penalties, no civil lawsuits. They took a walk.
Yeah, they walked away with it, and it was them who did it. It was their fault. Right. Yeah, and it's funny how all that works out. But anyway, Tom, this has been fun. I could do this for another hour.
But well, how about this? How about we continue the conversation, but I interview you?
I'll do that. Let me know when.
I'd love to talk to you about how you've used podcasting within your business.
Anytime. Yeah, because that's the one thing, because I didn't tell you. So I have this one, Inner Edison Podcast, which is your greatest competence come from your greatest defeats. Then I have Helping the Brave, which is for taking as a veteran, taking your uniform off. And then I also do what other one? I do ACES 53, which was from my college days in sales. An instructor said, remember 4 ACES and a joker: attitude, commitment, enthusiasm, smile. And the joker is that unique ability you bring to sales. And so ACES and a joker was taken by a band. So 53 is the first joker in the deck, right? Card. So that's why it's ACES 53. So I do a sales one twice a week. But from what I'm hearing from you, I need to do everything at daily.
You will own your space.
Well, because doing that daily with the guy from the radio show, morning 8:30 every day, Monday through Friday, it's amazing how many people he says walk up to him and say, I love your guys' show. But what people don't realize is unless they actually click on the show and Facebook, LinkedIn, or YouTube, that you don't know they watched it, right? Because it could be on Facebook. They could just be watching the words come across the screen, but they're not really honest. That doesn't count as a watch, but you can see impressions and the other stuff. And it's amazing how much you get from that kind of stuff. And it just takes time. Over time, you'll be the one person in the space that everybody remembers.
That's why looking at all of those numbers to show your total reach is so significant.
Right. And because I've had people who go, oh, you know, when I had them on, want to come on Helping the Brave, and they're like, well, what's your blah, blah, blah. And it's like, okay, we're here helping veterans. That's not what you say. First thing is, how can I be on? Because first of all, as Helping the Brave stands for veterans, we don't think we're heroes. We're not a hero. We're brave. We run towards that stuff. We're all messed up because of PTSD, because we all have PTSD from our childhood parents, this or that beating the hell out of us or whatever it was that caused that. That's why we go in the military in the first place. Most sane people don't go in the military.
My father died when he was 89. That was 10 years ago. He said to me exactly what you just said. And he served in World War II in Korea.
Because people always ask, it's like, you know, and I said, well, everybody wants to fix everybody. I go, well, once you do that, we'll never have anybody join the military. Because nobody, you know, it is getting to a point where they sit with a joystick most of the time. They're not any, but the military today is not like it used to be. It's an individual, not the sum anymore. And that's the problem we have with our country. It's no longer the country. It's the individuals, all about thousands and thousands of individuals instead of all here together. And I don't want to keep going. I'll keep going for an hour about that. So you can interview me on your podcast for that. Tom, well, how do people?
I'll tell you my mother's story about shared sacrifice sometime.
Well, you can do that. Where do people find you first?
The Compliance Podcast Network site, compliancepodcastnetwork.net. You can reach me on LinkedIn, Thomas R. Fox. You can email me at tfox@tfoxlaw.com.
And I'll put that all in the show notes for everybody, and I'll let you know when it gets released. And Tom, thank you so much for being on the show today. I really appreciate it. I had a great time with you.
Ed, thank you. It was my pleasure.